Buen día. He apagado el micrófono.
Buenos días, ¿cómo va? Okay, pues buenos días, bienvenidas todas y todos al curso avanzado de Croco. Esta es un poco la cómo nos vamos a organizar en esta sesión. Este curso se originó como parte del magíster en geofísica y bueno, cuenta con el apoyo de LEGOS, el IRD, el Centro Supercómputo, donde haremos las simulaciones, Reuna, que provee la cuenta Zoom, y ha participado gente de, tenemos docentes del IFOP, de IFREMER, del CISES, también tenemos la cooperación de Copernicus de Europa. Entonces, el comité organizador estuvimos Lionel Renaud del IRD y quien les habla. Esta parte avanzada tuvimos más de 50 postulaciones, pudimos acomodar a 34 personas. 13 de estas personas vienen desde el curso básico y hay 9 mujeres, 25 hombres de los países que ahí se destacan. La idea de este curso es que sea de nivel avanzado, ustedes de tener un conocimiento básico al menos de lo que es el uso de Croco, y nos vamos a enfocar en tres herramientas que son el uso de simulaciones bioquímicas, ya específicamente con el modelo PISCES, hay varios como mencionamos en el curso anterior, las herramientas de acoplamiento para océano-atmósfera usando OASIS, y el último día veremos sobre la experiencia que tenemos en Chile en el uso de pronósticos numéricos del océano. Y la continuación del curso básico. La idea es que después de este curso ustedes puedan practicar, o sea, yo creo que hay una necesidad de que practiquen por lo menos durante 6 meses para tener una buena experiencia con estas herramientas. Preguntas, bueno, durante el curso, probabilidad es que les pongan en el foro oficial de Croco, que es un desarrollo común de información. Y bueno, como decía, el éxito de este curso, más que nada, no está en cuántas personas hagan el curso, sino cuántas personas en 6 meses o el año próximo siguen preguntando, cuántas personas siguen usando siguen interesados en el tema. Este es el grupo docente que tenemos para esta segunda semana. Hoy presenta Renzan Cheván, trabajaremos con Odette Vergara en la tarde también. La siguiente sesión estará Lionel Renaud, Sven Julien y Rachid Benchila. Y el último día trabajaremos con Gildas Cambón y Osvaldo Artal. Ah, ¿ayudantes? No, ahora no. Son 6 bloques de 45 minutos. Intentaremos hacer pausas entre los bloques. 3 bloques de presentaciones en la mañana y 3 horas. Bueno, en la práctica funciona como de corrido en la tarde de esto. Las clases son como ahora, vía Zoom, y vamos a emitir en YouTube Live. El material docente lo vamos a colocar en ese enlace. Ahí van a estar las presentaciones y archivos que se requieran, los tutoriales. Y mientras hagamos la práctica en el centro de supercómputo, la interacción será usando Discord. Las guías, la idea es mostrar cómo se hacen ejercicios en la zona de Benguela, que es como una zona de, por defecto, bastante bien probada. Sabemos que los códigos funcionan ahí. Y después, una vez que lo completen, por favor, implementen esto en su zona de interés. El centro de cómputo es donde el ambiente donde vamos a trabajar. Es un laboratorio nacional que permite acceso a mucho poder computacional. En particular vamos a tener 4 servers dedicados de 20 cores cada uno. Como certificado de participación se requiere que tengan el 100% de asistencia a las prácticas. Se les va a pedir un informe escrito de alguna de las sesiones prácticas, no más de 5 figuras, o sea, 5 páginas. La idea es saber qué aprendieron y una evaluación de términos y conceptos, además de una encuesta final. Este curso, los que puedan, los que quieran, existe como curso de posgrado dentro de la Universidad de Concepción bajo ese código y si lo quieren inscribir, tiene un crédito. Ahora, nuevamente, vamos a usar una gran computadora, podemos hacer una simulación muy larga, pero no olviden que eso no significa que estamos haciendo ciencia. Esta es una herramienta para plantear preguntas correctas. Y no hay que perder el foco, que eso es lo que tenemos que dedicarnos, concentrarnos. Entonces, lunes y martes veremos pisques, miércoles y jueves interacción atmósfera y el viernes pronóstico oceanográfico. Voy a subir esta presentación ahí al servidor, pero esta es la lista de personas asignadas a cada cuenta para que encuentren con quién. Se van a comunicar durante la sesión. Pueden trabajar las dos personas en una misma configuración o si pueden ingresar a la vez también y crear directorios paralelos donde cada uno desarrolle el problema por su parte. En fin, ustedes escogen cómo trabajar, pero es posible en ambas modalidades. La otra lista de personas. Recordarles, esta es la página oficial del modelo Croco. Hay un repositorio del código, si ustedes quieren bajar el código más actualizado a su computador propio. Este es el foro donde manejaremos las preguntas. Hay un tutorial, una lista de documentación asociada al modelo que es bastante buena. Les recomiendo que vayan leyendo lo que les interese ahí. Hay una máquina virtual que se llama Live Croco, que también es disponible si es que no han podido instalar desde cero y quieren trabajar en un ambiente propio en su computador. Pero bueno, estas son las instrucciones básicas. Los dejo ahora con el trabajo de las presentaciones de avanzar. Es todo tuyo.
Hola a todos, como lo he dicho a Andrés, hablo español, pero la presentación va a ser en inglés, pero si hay preguntas, las pueden hacer en español, ¿eh? Y puedo tratar de contestar en español. Ok, I will share my screen now. So, yes. Partager. I hope you can all see my screen. Please, someone say yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, thank you. And can you also see the mouse?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, great. Okay, so let's start. So as Andrés told you, I'm Vincent Echevin. I have worked a lot with, for a long time at least, with Chilean colleagues, Andrés, we've known each other for a long time, and also with Odette Vergara, who will be the teacher teaching the practical class this afternoon. And also, I must acknowledge Olivier Aumont, who helped, who did some of the slides that I'm going to present today, and who is also the, let's call him the father of PISCES for many years. And I work at IRD. IRD is a French institute, Instituto Francés de Investigación para el Desarrollo, which is funding a lot of research with collaboration with countries in South America, Africa, India, Asia. Okay, so that's the outline of my course. The first 45 minutes, maybe a bit less, will be about generalities on the coupling between ocean dynamics and biogeochemistry. So I think a lot of things presented there you already know, but I think it's necessary to talk a little bit about that. The second part, will be really about the PISCES model. So it will be a much harder part because there will be a lot of equations to describe what is really in PISCES. So I will try to make it as clear as possible. Of course, we will not see all the code, but we will see a great part of it. And then the third part will be on some example of scientific studies done with the PISCES model. So that's more or less the three courses. And then this afternoon and tomorrow, you will have courses and practical courses with Odette Vergara. Okay, so well, these presentations will be about the PISCES code, but I will not focus on general modeling concepts in concepts in biogeochemistry. For instance, I will not talk about complex plankton models and complex organic matter models, which are part of biogeochemistry, which are also part of PISCES. But if you want to learn about that, you will have to read some papers by yourself. I will not talk about zooplankton models because, as you will see in PISCES, it's relatively simple. There are just two zooplankton groups. But there exist models with more complex zooplankton groups. And also, I will not talk about the biogeochemical cycles in the sediment. So now, in the newest PISCES versions, there will be also coupling with the sediments, and I will talk a little bit about that. But very briefly, I will not describe in detail what happens in this new compartment of PISCES. So is my speed of speech correct, or do I need to slow down, or you're all comfortable with English, I hope?
Yes, it's fine.
Okay,
yes.
Great. Thank you. Okay, so I continue. So first, we are going to, I'm going to explain really the basics about the coupling between dynamics and biogeochemistry. And then we will talk about how biogeochemistry can feed back on the dynamics. I will give a few basic concepts and then some effects that are limiting the phytoplankton growth, and talk a little bit about the heterogeneity of phytoplankton. So really, this basic introduction is more focused on phytoplankton. So first, okay, there is the first part is really on coupling, the coupling between dynamics and biogeochemistry, and how the dynamics impacts the biogeochemistry. So you all know that the circulation of the fluid is very important for biogeochemistry. In fact, when you start to do some modeling, sometimes you think that your model, your physical model is okay, but when you start to use a biogeochemical model, you find some crazy things in the biogeochemistry that actually are the cause of some errors, of some discrepancies in the physical part. So it's really important to have the correct physics before you switch to biogeochemistry. So it's really important to have the good CROCO simulations, or at least the best that you can have, before you switch on your PISCES model. That's the first idea. So let's talk about first the transport of phytoplankton by the geophysical fluid. Phytoplankton means, if you decompose the word, phyto means plant, and plankton means, in fact, in Greek, a plant that moves without goal. So it's really what happens in a lot of models is that the phytoplankton, as many other parts of the biogeochemical models, they are just transported by the fluid. They don't have any capacities to choose where they want to go, like fish, for instance. Okay, so it's different from terrestrial ecosystems where the plants, they do not move. So here they move with the fluids.
They are transported by horizontal and vertical currents. So this is a little bit the diagram that I showed here. So you have Z is the vertical, and there are horizontal and vertical currents that can move phytoplankton up and down. There is also something that is treated a little bit treated differently in models is the mixing, especially the vertical mixing. So if you all know CROCO, you know that there is a special parameterization for vertical mixing. And this vertical mixing is supposed to mix up and down, or to transport up and down phytoplankton. And so what is really important for the growth of phytoplankton is that it is transported in a vertical gradient of light. So the vertical gradient of light is shown here by this red line. And of course, you have more light in the surface layers than in the subsurface layers, because light is absorbed by the water. And when you push up and down with the currents, the phytoplankton, it gets in a place where there is more or less light, so it can grow more or less due to the process of photosynthesis. Okay. So here is a kind of a general sketch of the system. You have the phytoplankton, and phytoplankton is related to, is very strongly linked to nutrients. Sorry, is someone trying to talk? No? Okay. So the second very important part compartment of the biogeochemical system is the nutrients. And these nutrients are also dissolved nutrients. So they are like a concentration in the water, and they move with the water. So they are submitted to transport and vertical mixing as well. And when these nutrients come to the surface layer where there is light, and also where there is carbon, the process of photosynthesis occurs, and there can be primary production. And primary production is the function that produces phytoplankton. Okay. Then another important compartment of the system is dissolved organic matter. So organic matter is matter that has incorporated carbon. It is different from inorganic matter, where you have elements that are generally separated in different compartments. For instance, you can have inorganic carbon in the dissolved inorganic carbon. So this is it can be ions, or it can be dissolved CO2, for instance, is part of the dissolved inorganic carbon. But organic matter is carbon plus oxygen plus nitrogen, etc. And so one part of the system is a dissolved organic carbon, which is produced by, for instance, excretion or a lot of results from incomplete primary production, etc. So a lot of very small organic components are dissolved, and these components are also moved by the plankton, by the fluid. So by the horizontal and vertical transport, and also by the vertical mixing. And then you have the bigger organic cells, like zooplankton. It's also organic matter, but it's really alive organic matter in the case of zooplankton. And zooplankton is also transported by the fluid. You can have bacteria. So I will not talk much about bacteria because they are not explicitly modeled in PISCES. And you also have particulate organic matter. So particulate organic matter is more the matter that is not alive anymore. So it can be fecal pellets from the zooplankton, for example. It can be corpses from dead phytoplankton, or from dead zooplankton, or even from fish. And so this particulate organic matter is in general relatively big and not dissolved, so it is submitted to gravity, and it eventually sinks out of the surface layer. And this is what we call export to the deep ocean. Okay, so that's one way to see the coupling, how the physics or the hydrodynamics influences the biogeochemistry. But the reverse is true. The biogeochemistry can also impact the dynamics. So there are two effects. The first simple effect and easy to understand, and rather straightforward, is the effect that is due to the absorption of solar radiation. Because you have phytoplankton in the surface layer, and you have solar energy, so this solar energy is absorbed by the phytoplankton to do the photosynthesis. So it is used, and during this use, it is also transformed in heat released to the water around the phytoplankton. So if you have a very high concentration of phytoplankton in the very surface layer, it means that it's going to be very turbid, and so that the solar light will not be able to go through this layer. It will be all absorbed in this layer. And so it's easy to understand that since all this energy is released then in a form of heat to the fluid, you are warming the surface layer. So if you are warming the surface layer, you are changing the temperature in the surface layer, so you are changing the density. And if you change the density of the fluid, you also change the pressure gradient, etc., and you change the circulation. Okay, so here I have put a big warning, because in fact, this effect is not parameterized in Procopiscus in the present version. So it is often neglected, in fact, in coupled physical biochemical models, but it can be important in some regions. I will not insist much about that, but in the version that we will use now, it is not coded. This means that, in fact, the light the light of the sun that influences the physics is not directly absorbed by the phytoplankton. So there is kind of an inconsistency in that, but this effect is relatively weak in most cases. There is also an indirect effect of the feedback of biogeochemistry on the physics. This indirect effect is the following, is that if you have phytoplankton near the surface that absorb a lot of, during photosynthesis, they absorb a lot of dissolved CO2, they will decrease the CO2 concentration in the surface layer, and this will impact the RC exchange of CO2. Okay, so this RC exchange of CO2 will be changed, so there will be less or more CO2 in a certain region in the atmosphere. So there will be less or more greenhouse effect. And if you have more or less greenhouse effect, then you change again the heat fluxes back to the ocean, and so you change the temperature and you change the circulation. So you can see that it's relatively complex the way that biogeochemistry can impact the physics. And this is really something that is really important if you have like global scale models, if you study climate, you need to take into account this effect. But in the rest of the course, I will not mention it in more detail. Okay, so now just a few concepts and tools useful in biogeochemistry. So I will mention C-color data that I think most of you already know. Also the mixed layer, redefine what is the mixed layer, what is the euphotic layer. And I will explain how the phytoplankton growth is limited. Okay, so first, one very useful data that is used when you study biogeochemistry in the ocean is to use C-color data. So there exist a lot of satellites since the 1980s that measure sea color data, like CZCS, CWIFS, MERIS, MODIS. So a lot of you maybe have already used CWIFS or MODIS more recently. This kind of data is passive. So there is no signal that is sent from the satellite to the ocean and that comes back. It's really an observation, passive observation of the ocean in different wavelengths. And the chlorophyll is derived from the reflectance ratio of a different wavelengths. So I will not get into detail of this. So this is really the basic product that is used with sea color data. And now there are also more recent algorithms that can be used to identify, for instance, surface organic matter. So it's kind of interesting because you can follow kind of a proxy between phytoplankton, zooplankton, and organic matter in the surface layer. So it's really great to have these observations, but there are two problems. One problem is that with the sea color data, you cannot see, you can measure the chlorophyll in the mixed layer, but if you have little chlorophyll in the mixed layer, but really a lot at depth, as in the case of subsurface chlorophyll maximum, you cannot really see it. So that's a problem. You don't have a full observation of the system. And also the other problem is that these measurements are done in the band of what is it called in English? The visible band. So if there are clouds, there are no measurements. So that's the problems that you have, the limitations that you have with this kind of observations. Then the typical resolution in time is one image per day, and you can use also relatively high resolution images up to 1 kilometer. And you can have products that are composites of several days to avoid at best the clouds. Another example of the products that are more and more developed using satellite data and useful for biogeochemistry and in particular for phytoplankton is to derive different types of phytoplankton using color observations. So there is algorithms that have been developed, and now you can discriminate, for instance, in this map, you can see different colors, and different colors indicate that the majority in each color class is due to either diatoms in red. So you have a lot of diatoms in the southern oceans. In green, you have a very small phytoplankton, Prochlorococcus. In yellow, also in the Cynecococcus, very small, that are in the gyres. And in blue, you can have the coccolithophores. So there can be actually a lot of information that can be derived from satellite observations and from sea color data. Okay. Now, I'm going back to these very basic concepts, but obviously you know them. So the mixed layer is a very important variable in biogeochemistry. So the mixed layer is the surface layer where you have a constant concentration of nutrients, of salinity, but also a constant temperature. And then, for instance, for temperature, you have a decrease. And the other very important variable is the euphotic layer. So the euphotic layer is the depth at which 1% of the surface solar radiation is found. So it means it's really the depth where all the surface radiation has been absorbed by the fluid and by the phytoplankton as well. Okay, so the two different, in fact, the difference of depths between the mixed layer and the euphotic layer will be very important, as we will see in the following. Okay, so this is an example of a euphotic layer and surface chlorophyll. So here on the top left, you have a surface chlorophyll, a map from CWIFS, and what you can see in blue are regions where you have very low chlorophyll. So if you have very low chlorophyll near the surface, in general, your light, the light is able to propagate at very great depth. And so if you look here at the euphotic layer, so this is the depth of the euphotic layer, you have a much deep, very deep euphotic layer that is around 100, 120 meters here in the South Atlantic. So, and if you go to regions where you have a lot of chlorophyll at the surface, well, you will have very shallow euphotic layers. For instance, here in the upwelling region, it's more like 20, 30 meters, and you have a lot of chlorophyll, up to between 1 and 10 milligram per square meters of chlorophyll. Okay, and now the mixed layer. So I think you all know that. So there is a great variability in space of the mixed layer and in the global ocean. So for instance, here is the mixed layer in two different seasons. This is a boreal winter and a boreal summer. So in boreal winter, you have a very deep a mixed layer in the northern atmosphere, in the northern hemisphere, sorry, because you have a lot of wind and it's cold, so you have a very deep mixed layer, and it's much more shallow in summer, because you have less wind and you have a lot of heating from the sun. And so the criteria, there are different criteria, but one of the common criteria to derive the mixed layer is a difference of temperature. So you are at the depth of the mixed layer when the temperature is equal to the temperature at 5 meter depth minus half a degree. So it, when it's colder than the temperature at 5 meter depth. Okay, I'm just checking the time. Yes, we have another 10 minutes. So now let's talk about some limiting factors for phytoplankton growth. So I mentioned it a little bit previously, but the abundance of nutrients and the role of light and the role of vertical mixing. So this is a, for example, a section of nitrate in the North Atlantic between 0 and 500 meters, and between 5 north of the equator and 60 north. And what you can see is that there is a very strong gradient horizontally. You have in the south part, you have a very relatively low concentrations, around 2 micromoles of nitrate. In the north, it goes to 10. And if you go at depth, 300 meters, here in the red, you have something like 30. So there are very large magnitudes. And so to be able to create a phytoplankton, you need some physical process that may transport nitrate from the regions where there are lots of nitrate to regions where there are not a lot of nitrate. So it can be vertical mixing, it can be vertical advection, etc. Or it can be also convective transport in winter, which means that in winter you have a very deep mixed layer. So when you have a very deep mixed layer, you mix at you can erode the nutrient line, the thermocline, etc. until very deep. And so you homogenize the nutrient in the water column with a lot of concentration initially at the bottom. So you put a lot of nutrient in the surface layer. This is a convective transport, which occurs during winter generally. Okay. And so yeah, there is also, this was the limitation by nutrients. Now, there is also a limitation by light and mixing. So this simple schematic is showing you in this layer in white is the euphotic layer. And from the surface to this height is DM is the mixed layer. DE is the euphotic layer, DM is the mixed layer. And what happens is that the time taken for phytoplankton cell to replicate is a few days, 1 or 2 days. And when you have a lot of mixing, when you have mixing in the mixed layer, in fact, the velocity is really high. So you have, for instance, a particle can make 1,000 meters in 1 day. So the time scale for a phytoplankton cell to cross the mixed layer, which is around between 10 and 100 meter depth, can be from 0.01 to 0.1 day. So it's much shorter than the time scale for the doubling of phytoplankton, which means that we consider that the phytoplankton can move, is moving up and down a lot of time, all the time in this mixing layer, and that in fact it sees the mean light that it sees for its growth is the light that is contained in the euphotic layer, of course. So if the mixed layer is very deep, you can easily understand that the particles are spending a lot of time in the dark side, and so that it will not feel a lot of light. It will not very few light will be available for its growth. It's really proportional to the ratio of the euphotic layer versus the mixed layer. If you imagine that the mixed layer becomes greater and greater and greater, the phytoplankton parcel will spend less and less time in the euphotic layer, and so it will be able to grow very, very low. In fact, what we can say so is that if the mixed layer is greater than the euphotic layer, you have a limitation by mixing. Okay, so now let's talk a little bit about the diversity of plankton and its spatial heterogeneity. So I'm coming back to these maps of surface chlorophyll measured by sea weeds here, and so you can see that here I have highlighted the gyres with very low concentration. So this you can have very low concentration around 0.1 milligram per square meters. So there are very strong contrasts. Because if you look, oops. Okay. Now, if you look at the equatorial regions, you have a higher chlorophyll. And why is that? It is because you have equatorial divergence due to the wind, and so you have a pooling of nutrients. At high latitudes, also, you have high concentrations. Why is that? It's not because of a pooling. It's because of what I mentioned, very, very cold winters, or even summers are really cold. But so you have a very deep mixed layer. And this deep mixed layer, during winter, for instance, they can bring a lot of nutrients to the surface. Okay.
Vincent,
yes,
you can push masker, I think so.
Ah, yes, sorry, you're right. Yes, sorry, you were seeing this all the time. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Okay.
No problem.
Okay, so I'm continuing, I'm going on. So still again, the coastal regions. So in the coastal regions, you have high chlorophyll from 1 to 10 micrograms. So it's particularly strong in eastern boundary upwelling systems because you have, divergence of the wind and you have vertical transport of nutrients. So it creates a lot of biological productivity there. And also in regions where you don't have coastal upwelling, if you are in shallow regions, you can have a lot of input from the sediments because the sediments also release some nutrients, in particular iron. But also you can have rivers that can also give you a lot of biochemical quantities, nutrients, but also organic matter, etc. And also you have the, when you are close to the coast, also the wind can deposit some dust that is also bringing nutrients to the ocean.
Hola, ¿se escucha bien? Yo no escucho bien a Gonzalo.
Ah. You cannot hear me well?
I can hear you.
Yo lo escucho bien.
Yes,
okay. I can hear you.
Okay, so Andres, it seems to be a problem with your computer. Okay, so I'm continuing. Okay, so now this was heterogeneity in space. We are also have very strong heterogeneity in size. So phytoplankton size can cover at least two orders of magnitude. You have very slow, very small plankton that can be less than 1 micrometer. Which is called picophytoplankton. Then nanophytoplankton can be between 2 and 20 micrometers, microphytoplankton 20 to 200 micrometers, and you can even have colonies of phytoplankton that are cells that glue together that can reach millimeters to centimeters. So of course, I will come back to that. You will see that in PISCES it's very simple because we decided, not we, but Olivier decided to separate this into two classes, nanophytoplankton and a bigger phytoplankton. So I will come back to that. And if you look at the graph here on the bottom left, this is the contribution of size to the total biomass. So this is here on the vertical axis, the percentage of very small phytoplankton. So when you are at very low biomass, for instance, 0.1 milligram of chlorophyll per cubic meters, almost all the cells are very small. So you have 100% of very small cells. But when you increase the biomass, you also you increase the cell size also, and when you are at very high biomass, for instance 10 milligram of chlorophyll, you have almost 99% of the you have just 1% of small cells, and 99% are much bigger cells. So there is really an increase of the cells of phytoplankton when you have a higher mass. Alors, it is important to have these size of phytoplankton, they matter a lot for biogeochemical cycles first. Why is that? Is that because the big cells, and it's easy to understand, if you have big cells, they tend to sink rapidly when these cells are dead or when they degenerate. So they sink relatively rapidly, and so they get out of the surface layer. So this creates an efficient export of carbon. Okay. And also the big cells, they tend to form strong blooms. It means that they tend to have short regimes of very strong intensification and then decay. For instance, diatoms in aquatic systems. They're also important for the trophic chains. Because when you have big cells, generally you have shorter trophic chains. Why is that? It's also relatively easy to understand, is that the bigger phytoplankton cells, they can be consumed directly by fish. So some fish are able to feed on phytoplankton. And so you have a short chain because these fish are eaten by bigger fish, or even they are taken by fishermen. So there is a short chain. Also, the big cells, they allow a higher transfer of energy from one trophic level to the other. So they are really efficient trophic change. And there is an efficient transfer of energy to the higher predators. So it's also why one way to explain why in upwelling systems you have such a lot of fish, etc. You have a lot of plankton, but also you have these big cells that produce short trophic chains and a lot of higher predators or fish. Okay, so yes, I wanted to say I will skip this one and give you directly some example of phytoplankton. So for instance, very small cells that are called cyanobacteria. They're very small, but they can form colonies. They contribute to primary production in regions where there is no nutrient coming from the ocean. For instance, in subtropical gyres, there is almost no upwelling because they are very quiet regions, and also the thermocline is very deep. So what happens is that they are able to directly fix atmospheric nitrogen, which is dissolved in the surface layer. So it is very special, and it is something. This kind of primary production is parameterized in Pisces. Diatoms are more famous in so they are big cells, and they are always present in upwelling systems. They can have different shapes. And they also are important for silicate, so they need a lot of silicate for their skeleton, or it's also called frustule. So diatoms are also parameterized in Pisces, in Pisces V2. And they constitute one of the two species, the two groups of phytoplankton in Pisces. Another example is the dinoflagellate. So these are bigger cells, much bigger cells, in fact, and they can reach 1 millimeter. And what is important in these phytoplankton cells is that they have a flagell, which you can show here, and they are able to swim, in fact, to swim vertically, so they can migrate vertically, which is a little bit complex for modeling, especially the kind of modeling that is done in Pisces, which is Eulerian modeling, but they can be modeled using Lagrangian modeling, but I will not mention that. So they are not parameterized in Pisces, the dinoflagellates, even though they can be really important in some places. So they don't like turbulence. They can be mixotrophs. So mixotrophs are species that eat both phytoplankton. So they are like zooplankton, but they also can produce chlorophyll by photosynthesis. And so these types of phytoplankton are not parameterized in Pisces. And so they are abundant in summer and fall blooms because they need low wind conditions. And some species are toxic and can form the red tide. And also a last class that I want to mention is premiosophytes. There are cells around 20 micrometers. They can form important blooms. Two particular species are famous because, for instance, Phaeocystis form some colonies, and they produce aerosols, dimethyl sulfur aerosols, that can be released to the atmosphere, and this is important for cloud formation. So this is one example that I did not mention of the impact also of biogeochemistry on climate. A direct impact through the impact on clouds, not on CO2 this time. And then you have coccolithophores that have a shell of calcite and can also be identified from space with these specific algorithms. Okay, so I'm at the end of this first course, which were mainly about generalities. I think we're going to have a break. I hope you're still there. Yes. If you have some questions, maybe we can take 5 minutes for some questions, or we have a break. What time is it? Yes, we have a 10-minute break. Are there any questions?
Yes. Preguntas.
You said before in the last slide that this kind of cystis can affect the weather, the cloud weather.
Yes, not directly, but yeah. what they produce is some particles. So they live at the surface and they can produce some particles that are. I'm not an expert, huh, but what I understand is that with the wind, they can produce. I don't know the name in English nor in Spanish, but it's you know the water that you feel when you are near the ocean and there is a lot of wind, you feel this humidity, and so there are particles. Yes. These particles are really light and they can be transported in the atmosphere at high altitude, and they can help the formation of clouds.
Okay, thank you.
So they have an impact on the clouds. It's not a biogeochemical impact, but they allow aerosols allow to. The water vapor in the atmosphere to make small droplets and to create the cloud, in fact. Okay?
Yes, thank you.
Vincent, I have a question.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Well, I am not sure if you work with biogeochemical product from Copernicus Service. But it is there is a global product that uses PCS model. I am not sure if this kind of product can reproduce adequately the nitrogen or oxygen cycles, particularly in eastern boundary upwelling system. No.
Ah, okay. So. I don't know what makes you say that. I mean, it depends in the regions, I think. I mean, I know that they have made some progress. I could not tell you recently. I haven't used this product. This is a more maybe a technical question. If you for PISCES, what should we use at the boundaries? Should we use Mercator? Should we use World Ocean Atlas or something like that? I think that each region deserves a dedicated study of comparison between the observations and the Copernicus product. So I think that Copernicus is making progress because they have now a relatively high resolution for the physics. So I think that in terms of upwelling, they should be upwelling currents, they should be relatively okay. Now for the biogeochemistry, there are still some problems for oxygen, for instance, but I could not say something general. I think I would advise if you're aiming at using PISCES for some time, a few years, or if you really have the intention to develop a project on this, I think for the future, it's really interesting to use these kind of products, Copernicus. But it deserves a close investigation of the field.
Okay. Sorry, in your experience, I can use the biochemical output from this global product. Is it possible use or is recommend using regional ocean model like CROCO or not?
I'm not sure I understood your question. I'm not sure I understand your question. Do you want to know if I recommend using CROCO? Yes. If you do a regional oceanography, you use CROCO. I think it's a good choice, of course. And then if you do biogeochemistry, I would also recommend to use PISCES because for instance, in many regions, it's a good model. But
No, sorry, lo expliqué mal en
It was
inglés.
not the question. En español, quizás.
Sí, sí, lo expliqué mal, disculpa. Si puedo, si recomendarías usar las salidas del producto global en un product, en un modelo regional. Como
yes, so that's what I was saying, is that I cannot recommend it like directly like this, but I think if you look carefully at the for instance the World Ocean Atlas, and you compare your Copernicus data, you can make a decision looking at the errors that it's better or not to use it. I cannot say in general, but I think I advise people to at least give a look at this product, because it's the only product that exists in the world where you have a consistency between the physics and the biogeochemical field at the boundaries, for instance. I think we're getting a little bit ahead of other discussions, but what a lot of people do, and myself, I have done it a lot, is to take the physics from Copernicus, so they have a lot of variability, interannual variations, etc. And then I use the boundary conditions for the biogeochemistry from the World Ocean Atlas. So they are not consistent. It gives good results. Sometimes it gives really good results with doing that. Huh? So I'm not saying it's bad, but it's not consistent, because when you have a lot of variations in the boundaries of the physics, you should have corresponding variations for the biogeochemistry. And when you do that, technically, you don't take them into account. Okay?
Okay, thanks.
Okay.
Any questions? Well, no, okay. Sí, hacemos una pausa. Okay.
Voy a cortar la transmisión y luego reiniciamos otro enlace de
¿Cuántos YouTube? Minutos?